ברוכים הבאים לאירוע השקה של תוכנית ה-BO-MBA המחודשת של המסלול האקדמי המכללה למינהל. הלו"ז שלנו להיום הוא קצר ואנחנו עוד נצופף אותו. אני רוצה לכמה דקות אולי להסביר לכם למה אנחנו כאן בעצם ומה הרעיון מאחורי התוכנית שלנו ומה אנחנו בעצם מנסים לקדם. יש לנו במהלך הדברים שלי, אמורה להיות לנו איזו שיחת סקייפ עם מנהלת התוכנית מג'ונס הופקינס, שאיתם אנחנו מקיימים את שיתוף הפעולה החל משנה הבאה, ואת הקורס שנדבר עליו שיוצא לדרך בעוד שבועיים כבר. ואז בשעה 5 בערך יצטרף אלינו הדובר שממנו יהיה לכם קשה לקבל את ההרצאה בעברית, דייוויד דורסט ממורגן סטנלי. בסיום ההרצאה של דייוויד יחכו לנו כוסות להשקה חגיגית של התוכנית הזה. בסיום ההרצאה נפגש כולנו בחוץ ונחגוג ביחד. רציתי להסביר לכם קצת הרציונל למה אנחנו עושים מה שאנחנו עושים. ויש לי, כמי שעובד בתעשיית הביומד בארץ בערך 10 שנים, דעה די מגובשת על התעשייה המקומית, שחלק גדול מכם בקהל, שהם הסטודנטים שלי, שמעו אותה לא פעם ולא פעמיים. אבל לטובת אלה שלא היו סטודנטים שלי, שווה אולי לשמוע אותה שוב. יש משהו נורא, נורא מרגש בלהיות בחו"ל ולדבר על ישראל. ישראל נחשבת כהאב מיזמי יחיד במינו בעולם. הספר סטארט-אפ ניישן, אבל סטארט-אפ ניישן כמושג הפך להיות מושג שגור בכל מוסד, גם אקדמי וגם עסקי בעולם. ודווקא התעשייה שלנו, תעשיית מדעי החיים, בתיאוריה הייתה אמורה להיות שותפה מלאה ושווה לתעשיית ההייטק בכל מה שקשור ליזמות. אנחנו מדברים על אומה שהפר קפיטה, רישום פטנטים והענקת פטנטים שלה הוא המוביל בעולם, או מקסימום מספר 2 לארצות הברית. הפרסומים המדעיים שלנו, כמובן חתני פרס הנובל, פר קפיטה, המדען הראשי נותן תמריצים מאוד משמעותיים לתעשיית מדעי החיים. יש לנו אוניברסיטאות מעולות ומכוני מחקר מעולים, בתי חולים מהטובים שיש בטח באזור שלנו ואולי בעולם. והשאלה שאני תמיד מציג לאנשים שמאוד עסוקים בלהגיד כמה אנחנו טובים, זה בסדר שאנחנו טובים, אבל האם אנחנו מממשים את הפוטנציאל? זאת אומרת, בהינתן כל זה, האם אנחנו as good as we can be? והתשובה שלי היא absolutely not. צריך לדעת שתעשיית מדעי החיים בארץ היא בעיקרה מרוכזת ב-medical devices. למעלה מ-50% מהמיזמים בארץ הם medical devices קטנים שמעסיקים מעט עובדים, ומחזור החיים שלהם מאוד מאוד קצר. אפשר אולי לספור על יד אחת את החברות שמייצרות הכנסות. אוקיי? Revenue generating, זה כאילו מילה גסה בביומד, אבל אשכרה חברות שמוכרות משהו ומקבלות תמורה עבורו בעולם הפארמה והביוטק. במד דיווייסס זה קצת יותר, אבל גם לא הרבה יותר, ובאגרוביו זה קצת יותר, אבל לא הרבה יותר. התעשייה הזאת שבעצם לא מצליחה לפרוץ, מייצרת גם הזדמנויות תעסוקה והכשרה מאוד מאוד מצומצמים. ואם קוראים את העיתונים, אז רואים שב10 שנים האחרונות, והייתה כתבה גדולה על זה לפני שנה-שנתיים, הכסף הפנוי להשקעה גם של משקיעים מוסדיים ופרטיים, וגם של קרנות הון סיכון, הולך ודועך. ואנחנו השנה נהיה באיזשהו שפל חסר תקדים של משאבים שמושקעים בתעשיית מדעי החיים. אנחנו נכנסים לאיזשהו מעגל, מין מערבולת אימה כזאת של אין הרבה כסף, אז המנהלים של חברות מדעי החיים מתחילים לחתוך. לחתוך בתוכניות, לחתוך בניסויים, לחתוך בהוצאות, לחתוך בפטנטים, שכמובן מוביל לפרפורמנס יותר גרוע. כי אם אתה לא עושה את הניסויים כמו שאתה צריך, או אתה לא משקיע בפטנטי כמו שאתה צריך, או לא לוקח את הזמן לבנות אסטרטגיה כמו שאתה צריך, אז כמובן הפרפורמנס יהיה נחות, וכמובן פרפורמנס נחות גורר השקעות יותר מוגבלות בתעשייה. והתעשייה נמצאת לטעמי באיזשהו סחרור של under performance, under investment. under performance, under investment. ובשלב מסוים צריך שמישהו יבוא ויגיד cut. אוקיי? בואו ננסה לשנות את המעגל הזה. צריך להבין, הפרדיגמה שלי מאוד פשוטה. אנחנו אומת הייטק. ו-guess what? ביוטק זה לא הייטק. אוקיי? אנחנו מדברים על אווירה רגולטורית, גם בפיתוח וגם בשיווק, שהיא אחרת לגמרי מההייטק, מחזורי זמן שמחרים לגמרי. האי-הוודאות הטכנולוגית בביוטק היא עצומה. אי-הוודאות הטכנולוגית בהייטק היא כמעט אפסית. כל ילד יכול לייצר אפליקציה לאייפון. שום ילד לא יכול לייצר מיזם ביומד אמיתי. אוקיי? לוחות הזמנים הם ארוכים, וגם כל בעיה שאתה נתקל בה בביוטק היא בעיה שמורכבת גם מהנדסה וגם מפיזיקה וגם מכימיה וגם מביולוגיה וגם מרפואה. אף אחד בביוטק לא יכול להיות מומחה רק בדבר אחד. ולכן התובנה שאני מקווה שתסכימו איתי, ואם לא אז אני אשמח להתווכח בפעם אחרת, זה שניהול מיזמים ביו-רפואיים הוא אחר לגמרי מניהול הייטק. עכשיו, זה דבר שאצלי כמובן, כמו תמיד, שקע מאוחר, אבל בעולם הכירו בו כבר לפני הרבה מאוד זמן, ובאוניברסיטאות המובילות בעולם, וורטון, קרנגי מלון, MIT, הרווארד, רטגרס, בארצות הברית ומחוץ אליו, וכמובן ג'ונס הופקינס, שאיתם אנחנו מקיימים קשר, הבינו את זה מזמן, והם לוקחים את אנשי תעשיית הביו ומכשירים אותם לניהול. הם הקימו תוכניות שמשלבות את את הרקע ואת העושר המדעי עם הצורך במיומנות ניהול שהיא מיוחדת לסביבה הזאת. וזו הסיבה שפתחנו את תוכנית ה-BIO-MBA, תוכנית שנפתחה לפני 4 שנים, הרבה מבוגריה וגם מהסטודנטים יושבים היום בקהל, והולכת ומתהווה ובעצם עומדת לפרוץ לקראת השיתוף הפעולה הגלובלי עם ג'ונס הופקינס. אבל הרעיון הוא שאנחנו מאמינים בתוכנית ה-BIO-MBA שכדי להצליח ברמה הטכנולוגית אתה גם צריך להיות מנהל מיומן. אנחנו מאמינים שהלימוד הטוב ביותר הוא לימוד של hands-on, מלווה באקדמיה, אבל hands-on. אנחנו מאמינים שלא כל ה-MBA זה אותו דבר, ואני מקבל המון שאלות, אבל למה לעשות MBA בביו? אני אעשה MBA רגיל. אז הסברתי לכם, ב-MBA רגיל תלמדו שיווק רגיל, מעולה, אבל רגיל, ושיווק מוצרים רפואיים הוא הכי לא שיווק רגיל שאתם יכולים ללמוד. זה דיסציפלינה אחרת לגמרי. אנחנו מאמינים בקבוצות קטנות, אנחנו מאמינים בכיתות מוגבלות בגודלם, ומאמינים בהשקעה בכיתות האלה כדי לייצר איזשהו נטוורק שגם הוא מאוד ייחודי. ב4 שנים מאז שפתחנו את התוכנית יש לנו למעלה מ-100 בוגרים, סטודנטים ובוגרים, שמהווים היום אולי את הרשת החברתית היחידה שקיימת בתעשייה שלנו בארץ. אוקיי, ILSI, ארגון העל של חברות מדעי החיים, התמזג כבר עם ארגון ההייטק. אז אין לנו כבר ארגון משלנו, ובעצם יש לנו היום סיטואציה שבה תוכנית הביו-MBA של המסלול ייצרה בעצם את התשתית הראשונה ל-100 ומשהו איש שכולם עובדים בתעשייה ומדברים ונפגשים וחלקם כאן, וזה איזושהי פלטפורמה להמשיך ולהעמיק את האינטראקציה בינינו. ה-MBA שלנו, ה-MBA היחיד מסוגו בארץ, הוא MBA לכל דבר, אבל בונה את התכנים של איך זה להיות או מה צריך לדעת מנהל בתחום מדעי החיים. אנחנו ממוקדים בתעשיית ה-healthcare, קוראים לזה באמריקה, זה כל מה שקשור במדעים, life science וכו. ובעצם מאפשרים גם לסטודנטים עם מעט ניסיון להיכנס לתוכנית, וגם עם סטודנטים שהם יחסית ברמה גבוהה, או עתירי ניסיון, או עם תארים אקדמיים מאוד גבוהים. כמעט חצי מהסטודנטים שלנו, הם מסתכלים אחורה על אותם בוגרים וסטודנטים, הם אנשים בעלי דוקטורט, או רופאים, או וטרינרים, או רוקחים, אנשים עם תארים שניים ושלישיים, והחצי השני הוא בעלי תואר ראשון, עם איזשהו ניסיון בתעשייה. אנחנו מעניקים לאנשים האלה גישה לא רק אחד לשני, אלא גם למרצים שכולם מגיעים מהתעשייה, ומאפשרים ליצור את הדינמיקה הזאת, את האווירה המיוחדת, שאנחנו מאמינים שתכשיר את האנשים האלה ללמוד אחד מהשני ומאיתנו, איך להצעיד את התעשייה הזאת קדימה, איך לשבור את המעגל הזה של, 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 של under performance, under investment. נתתי קצת דוגמאות של אנשים שמלמדים אצלנו בקורסים, משה מנור, נשיא טבע אסיה פסיפיק לשעבר, גיל הררי, מנכ״ל מדיסטאט, אמיר אמבר, מנכ״ל מדיקלבר, חנה אזולאי, עורך הדין בגילוני אזולאי, ליאת דיאמנטי, אשת רגולציה, מנכ״לית של דואט מדיקל, עינב הוא ה-CFO של נורוניקס, רונן שאני חושב יישב כאן בקהל, אני חושב שראיתי אותך רונן, אהלן, עבד שנים ארוכות גם ב-MSD וגם בטבע. הסטודנטים שלנו נחשפים לא לאנשים אקדמיים נטו, אלא לאנשים שמגיעים מהתעשייה ונותנים את המשנה הסדורה שלהם של איך זה להתמודד עם האתגרים היומיומיים בתעשייה. ביחד איתם, אותה אוכלוסייה של 100 בוגרים, גם תומכים אחד בשני ומקדמים ומעשירים אחד את השני. אנחנו פותחים תוכנית לשנה הבאה, וזה בעצם עיקר האירוע היום, שמאפשרת לסטודנטים מרקע שונה בתעשיית מדעי החיים להגיע וללמוד איתנו. יש לנו את תוכנית הביו-MBA הקלאסית, שהיא תוכנית לבוגרי תואר ראשון, שהיא נמשכת שנתיים, שני סמסטרים בשנה, והרעיון הוא MBA, עם התמחות בניהול ביו, כאשר בסוף ההתמחות מקבלים איזושהי הכשרה מיוחדת באחד משלושה אפיקים, רגולציה, שיווק או איכות. והדברים האלה, שלושת האפיקים האלה, נבחרו בשיתוף עם חברות השמה שעובדות היום בישראל, כאפיקים הקריטיים ביותר שבהם חסר כוח אדם לתעשיית ה-Life Science במדינת ישראל. בליב יתרונות לא חסר חוקרי מופ. במדינת ישראל, כל אחד שגומר תואר ראשון או שני בביולוגיה, הולך, מנסה לקבל עבודה כחוקר מו"פ. בתעשיות האלה של רגולציה, של שיווק ושל איכות, יש חוסר. יש חוסר באנשים מנוסים שמקבלים את ההכשרה הספציפית ויכולים לתרום לארגון. לצד זה אנחנו פותחים את השיתוף הפעולה עם ג'ונס הופקינס לתוכנית מיוחדת של ביו-MBA for executives. מדובר בתוכנית שתיפתח רק לאנשים או עם ניסיון משמעותי בתעשייה או עם תואר דוקטורט או אקוויוולנט של דוקטורט ומעלה. אנחנו מדברים על עדיין תוכנית של שנתיים, אבל שתלמד במשך שנה בקמפוס בראשון לציון של המסלול האקדמי. ובשנה השנייה התלמידים ילמדו אונליין במערכת האונליין של הופקינס, ויוכלו גם לנסוע להופקינס ולקחת קורסים שם. זה הכל חלק מאותה תוכנית. העלות כמובן היא טיפה יותר גבוהה. יש לכם את שני אנשי הקשר לתוכניות, לתוכנית הביו-MBA הקלאסית ולתוכנית הביו-MBA for executives מצד ימין, וגם מיכאל וגם מרסלו וגם אני נמצאים כאן, ונשמח לעזור לכם ולענות על שאלות. בעוד שבועיים יצאו סטודנטים שכרגע לומדים בתוכנית הביו-MBA. So in a couple of weeks, a few students from that are currently in the program, not candidates, but students that are in their second year in the bio-MBA program, are going to Johns Hopkins for a four-year intensive seminar with Johns Hopkins students. It's a mixed class of COMAS students, we should have a better name for that, but a College of Management Academic Studies students and Johns Hopkins students. The topic is tech transfer and commercialization. The campus at Johns Hopkins actually sits right between the NIH and FDA, two of the most influential institutions in the US for biomed development. And so that's where our students are going. A list of guest lectures that range from industry folks, regulatory folks, government people, army people, NIH, Howard Hughes, a lot of people coming into these students. This is done Johns Hopkins style, okay? So this is US academic style. Coming in, doing a lot of case studies, a lot of interviews, a lot of face-to-face time with the students. Before I introduce David, I wanted to just summarize and say we feel very strongly that the educational platform that we provide and the network that we have been building over the last 4 years is very meaningful to the industry. We feel very strongly about the kind of the visibility and the value that our graduates are contributing in their workforce. We get a lot of feedback and a lot of great stories about people who have done very well, have made transitions, and have moved up in their organizations or other organizations. And it makes us feel very proud and very kind of strengthened by the fact that we're seeing our vision come true, and we're hoping to take it one step further with the Johns Hopkins collaboration. So because we believe in learning by experience, and because we believe with putting world global experts in front of our students and in front of the community, I've taken the chutzpah, I should say liberty, but it's a little bit of a chutzpah, to draw on two friends of mine, an old friend of mine, Michal Dreiman, who's a graduate of the first class of our bio-MBA program, who works today at Jerusalem Venture Partners together with Erel Margalit. and a new friend, Yaakov Ringler, who works at Wealth Management at Morgan Stanley, to kind of pull Mr. Darst out of his busy schedule this year and get him to speak to you. I've heard a lot about David, but actually, apart from YouTube, I've never seen him perform, so I'm excited. Yaakov sent me David's bio. It would have literally taken me about 30 minutes to go through that. So I've given you highlights here. David has spent about 17 years at Morgan Stanley, really guiding the investment strategy of the group, was the president or founding president of the Morgan Stanley Investment Group, a prolific author of many books and articles in the area, as well as a prolific performer on various news and media events, MBA from Harvard Business School and a BA from Yale, and is a lecturer at all these amazing business schools. I was also a visiting faculty member at both Yale School of Management, Yale College, and Harvard Business School, a CFA charter holder and a member of the New York Society of Security Analysts, and I'm thrilled and grateful for you coming over and giving a talk. So David Darst, everyone.
Dr. Danielli, your own, thank you for having me. And I want to dedicate these brief remarks to a few people, and starting with Michal Drayman. And thank you for your friendship and encouragement and support to me and my colleagues over many years. And if you've known her a long time, you too, like I, are in love with her. She's a phenomenal professional, great investment person, and a great mother and human being.
And a great student, too.
Great student, great. My son, Dr. Danielli, and I want you to meet at some point. Michal has heard a lot about him, and he is a CEO of a small biotech company called Argenix, which is working with several people, PhDs at the Rockefeller University, and they're working on an anti-metastasis drug. They've gone from mice to rats to monkeys, and then the next step, you know, is to hopefully close to NDA and a phase one. So just a few thoughts here. I would like to dedicate these remarks not only to Michal, but to this woman at the top. She is the keeper of a blog, and she's been advocating to have women on the currency of Britain. She's a feminist, she's 29, Caroline Criado Perez, and she has been agitating for several years. She said, we have William Shakespeare, we have Charles Darwin, we have Michael Faraday, but we don't have any women. We have Queen Elizabeth on the back, but no one on the front, no women. So as you may know, this past year, the Bank of England nominated and confirmed a Canadian to run the Bank of England. That's never happened in 320 years. The Bank of England was founded in 1694. They've never had a non-British person run. They brought this guy, Mark Carney, who used to work with us at Goldman Sachs. But he was the central banker. He was the Ben Bernanke of Canada. Now he is that of his first official act was to put Jane Austen on the British currency. Now, I salute his forward thinking, because this connects to those are the 20 U.S. senators who are female. There are 100 senators. Blue is Democratic, red is Republican. And the reason the United States did not default last summer, there was an issue of maybe they would not pay their debt. These 20 women got into a room, Republican and Democrat, and said, we cannot let this happen. And they took charge. If you want something done right, ask a woman, okay? And they took charge. They took charge, and they are the reason. Everyone knows in the United States, these 20 courageous people are the reason we did not have a crazy financial accident. These are the women who run the 10 largest Fortune 500 companies. So General Motors today is run by a woman who started on the production line 26 years ago, Mary Barra. Pardon?
She drives a car.
She drives the car? What is your name, please?
Kobe.
Yeah, Kobe?
Yes, Kobe.
Kobe, thank you for... You see these people, okay? Not going to go through with all those. So this is what I would like to share with you a little bit about what has been happening in the world for the last 400 years, what has been happening in the last 14 years of this century, and what is happening in the last 2 years, okay? So basically, the 1700s, that's King Louis XVI, who was beheaded in the French Revolution at age 39 in 1793. But basically, the 1700s were about the abolition of monarchies, of all-powerful monarchies. A king could kill you, and no one could counteract his decision. If he didn't like the way you looked or you were not nice to him. The 1800s were about the abolition of slavery and serfdom. United Kingdom first, then Russia, then United States. 1863, Abraham Lincoln. The 1900s were about the abolition of fascism, totalitarianism, and communism. It's not totally wiped out, as you can see right now in the Ukraine, okay? The word Ukraine means frontier in Ukrainian. And it's approximately the size of Texas. It looks longer because it's stretched out. 47 million people, as you know. Stalin died in 55. Mao died in 1976, August of 76. And I've left off another guy who committed suicide in a bunker in Berlin in May of 1945. This lady is one of the people I'm dedicating these remarks to. That is Malala Yousafzai. Anybody heard of her? She keeps a blog. She is 16 years old, and she has been raised by her father the same as her brother, meaning they both go to school in northern Pakistan. Not just the girls stay home and the boy go to school. And the father has taught her she's equal to the brother. She keeps a blog about women equality, and the Taliban hate her. Now you can read in her book called I Am Malala, that's her first name. She said the Taliban guy got on the bus with his gun exposed and said, who of you is Malala? She said, that would be I, knowing I was going to be shot. And he went and shot her through the face, neck, and shoulder. And there she is in Birmingham, England, recovering. She was airlifted there, and her family has moved there with her. I urge all of you who are interested in women's rights, in young women's rights, and young men's rights, young people's rights, to go and put in YouTube, Pakistani girl addresses UN. Because on July 11th, last year, her 16th birthday, she gave a speech all by herself to the General Assembly. It's 6 minutes long, and it is phenomenal. It is as good as Martin Luther King's speech in front of the Washington Monument in 1963 in favor of civil rights. Now, these are the big stories of the 21st century. One is the rise of China. The rise of China basically started in 1978 when Mao died in 76. This guy, who is that? That is Deng Xiaoping. And he is the greatest structural reformer of the last 100 years. He wrote in his autobiography, I went to Hong Kong. I saw these people through the binoculars. I went to Shenzhen. I'm looking through the binoculars. They are driving Mercedes. They're driving Audi. They're driving Benz. They're Bentley Rolls. We're driving bicycles. And they look like us. They look Chinese. He said, they're wearing Prada, Gucci, Fiorucci. We're all dressed, men and women, the same thing. We got these little Mao collar things going. He said, I figured we would start trying special economic zone in Shenzhen. Shenzhen was a small, sleepy fishing village of 100,000. Shenzhen's 11 million people now. Secondly, who is that man on the right? He was sitting next to Sadat when Sadat was assassinated in 1981. That's Hosni Mubarak. Where is he now? He's in a cage. He's not in prison. He's in prison in a cage. He ran Egypt for 31 years. I do believe he liked Israel, or he was okay with Israel, okay? He liked Israel as much as an Egyptian can like Israel, okay? I say this to American audiences, okay? On the left, lower left, is, of course, you know who, Angela Merkel. And if she completes her term, which we hope and expect she will, it'll be 4 years times four years times three terms, 12 years. Margaret Thatcher was 11 years. So she will be the longest serving female leader in Europe history, other than queens, okay? And on the right, does anybody know him? That's the president of Colombia. That's Juan Manuel Santos. Mm-hmm. Now, what I tell American audiences, the big stories of this century are the rise of China, the Arab Spring, okay, the redefinition of Europe. But in all cases, the world is watching America to see what America does vis-a-vis Japan. I say to American audiences, the world is watching what America does vis-a-vis Israel, which will celebrate its 66th birthday in May. I say that to Americans. The world is watching, how does America treat its oldest ally, the United Kingdom? And the world is watching America, how are they going to treat Mexico? Because America today is 21% Latino Hispanic. And in 40 years, it will be 33% Latino Hispanic. I firmly believe for me to come in here and tell you yes, we've got to find one person in America who can say no. And that will be a woman, because women know how to say no. And it will probably be a Latina, because we're going to become, so Shakira for president. Okay, the last 400 years, the last 14 years, the last 2 years. So the last 2 years, the stock market has done very, very well in the United States. It went up 16% in 2012, and 2013, it went up 32%. Since March of 2009, it was 666. Today, it's 1,800. So it has tripled, 600 to 1,800. What are the reasons? Five no's and three yeses. The first no is Israel and Iran did not get into a fight, and there was no fight involving Syria. There was no Greek exit from the Eurozone. As a matter of fact, the Greek bonds, my colleagues know this very well, 2 years ago, the Greek bonds were yielding 33%. Do you know what they're yielding today? 6.7%. That means the price has gone from 13 to 74. Listen, Ukrainian bonds right now, they mature June of 2015. They're yielding 42%. They're supposed to give you 100 next June, and they trade for 70 now. 30 divided by 70 is 42%. Now, it's possible they could default, and they say, we're not paying you, and you end up in the courts for 10 years, and you get 5 cents for your 70.
Like Argentina and Russia and Brazil.
28.
It's Jacoby, right?
Yeah.
You know, Jacoby, I taught for 27 years, 9 years at Harvard Business School, 9 years at Yale Management School, 9 years at Yale College, and every year I had one like you. And I always fell in love with him.
Running a business, you know.
Like Jacoby said, and please feel free, anybody, please, shout out thoughts, ideas, reactions. Like Jacoby said, Argentina bonds. Maybe give a comment or two on how one could have made money in them.
They were,
when, you know, in some of the reorganizations that were
trade as low as 16, they ordered, it was, you know, the write-off was 75 cents, so you got basically 25 cents on the dollar. There were some combinations of warrants and what other things. They rallied ever since from the low 20s all the way to 70 or 80. But for instance, now Argentina, still 10 years later, or actually more, they defaulted in 01, they're still in the courts suing each other and, you know, the issue with the holdouts. So, no.
So, you know, the Greek bonds, the Irish bonds, you know, they went from 13% down to 3.1% last night. Now, with all the crazy turmoil in the markets yesterday in response to Crimea and Sevastopol and all that stuff, I don't know where the Irish bonds are, see, but last night, the night before the crazy stuff started, the real crazy stuff, Greece did not leave the Eurozone. China did not have a dramatic slowdown. The United States did not go into a recession. Congress did not totally shut the government down. The European Central Bank said we'll do whatever it takes to preserve the euro. The United States Federal Reserve continued printing money under quantitative easing 3 and quantitative easing 4, and we got two new sheriffs in Mexico and Japan. Yosemite Sam, have you ever heard of him? He's a cartoon character. And we got one in Japan and one in Mexico. So for the last 10 years, what have been the leading asset classes? Master Limited Partnerships, which is a form of investment in energy. Latin American equities, Mexico, which is within Latin American equities. These are in dollars. Emerging market equities, which Latin America and Mexico are in, gold, and Australian equities, which is a play on emerging markets, especially China. The worst ones, Dow Jones UBS commodities, oil, copper, corn, cash, managed futures, commodity trading advisors, hedge funds, fund of funds, Japan equities, and non-US bonds. Those are the stragglers, the laggards. Now, I can't come and tell Israel what to do. I can suggest what the United States needs to do. We need structural reform in the United States. We need a Bibi Netanyahu when he was finance minister. We need Margaret Thatcher. We need Reagan. We need Clinton. Clinton was a reformer. He signed NAFTA. He's the one that put Mexico, Canada, and the U.S. together. A Republican never could have done it because he was on the Democratic side. He was able to bring them and persuade them, okay? But what the United States needs is savings and investment. We need education and infrastructure, and education is not schools. Education is parents. School is icing on the cake. The cake is the parents. And we seem to have forgotten that. We have a lot of policies in the United States. We cannot force mothers and fathers to share parenting. But the destiny of a country is made not at the hearth of the open hearth of the steel mill. It's made at the hearth of the fireplace. And when my children were little, 5 and 7, now, I took them to the zoo one day. And they knew all the animals. I said, look at that monkey. They go, no, that's a robo baccoon. I go, what? They gave me the Latin name for it. I'm like, they're 5 and 2. I go home, my wife's a PhD. I said, sweetheart, am I a good father? She said, you're a phenomenal father. I said, I'm going to work 10 times harder after seeing what you have put into our children. I said, you must be one of the greatest, you are the greatest American mother. She said, stop right there. She said, my competition is not American mothers. It's Asian and Israeli mothers. I need to step up my game. Debt and deficits. Basically, the last 30 years have been very good if you're rich in America. The top 10%, the top 20%, the bottom 80%, the people that wear tool belts that do the real work, have not gotten much. And that's no way to run a country. That has to be addressed. And finally, the value of money. Right now, people are spending crazy money on art, contemporary and modern art. Jeff Koons, the toy dog, $58 million. Lucian Freud, portrait of Francis Bacon. It's crazy. It's ugly. That's the highest price ever made for a painting at auction so far, $142 million last year.
I'd like to hear your opinion and your input on healthcare reform and what to look for in terms of monetary.
Last year, as you know, the Supreme Court, by 5-4, reaffirmed the Affordable Health Care Act called Obamacare. People are getting very discombobulated. I don't know if you know this word, but it means, you know, it's a new world. And I don't know that we've seen all the acts. I think many of the authors of the legislation had not read the legislation. I think it's something like 3,000 pages long. And Nancy Pelosi, who was the head of the House at the time, she said, we have to pass it first, then we'll read it. That's a famous quote. That's like the Vietnam War. That general said, we have to destroy that village to save it. Okay, it's a famous quotation. So now, if you just say that, we have to pass it first, and then we'll read it. Everybody knows what that relates to. So health care costs as a percentage of the economy, the GDP in the United States is $17 trillion. I think the healthcare spending is about $3 trillion, something like that, okay? About six, if it's 18, that's, it's more, okay? It's about, it's over 10%, 11, 12, something like that. It's beginning to slow down. But it's not only what you spend, but the equality and the efficiency. And I don't think the last act of this drama has been written. I think this is the first iteration, this is the first attempt to do something. So healthcare is an important field, and I'm extremely excited about this cadre, this cohort that's studying a combination of these two fields, because the world is crying, Mariana, the world is crying for people who can bridge the world of healthcare and business. And that's where my son has become the CEO of that company, because he could intermediate between Rockefeller University and the venture capital people. The two people who founded Google, I've met them a few times. They're 40. They were born in 1973, both of them. Sergey and Larry, they'll be 41 this year.
I'm also 73.
Every man in this room, do never go near women with numbers about her weight or her age. Do not go near numbers. Okay? You need to be a poet, not a physicist or a mathematician on numbers. This is what Israel wishes it had, and I think Israel has this, but Germany wants it. UK would like it. France would love it. China would love to have this. Japan would want this. What is this? I asked them, why did you start Google? Because Yahoo was started in 94. You started Google in 98. Why did you start that? Because you already had a phenomenal internet search algorithm. They said, we did our paper at Stanford on internet search algorithm. We took it to the professor, Professor Ramakrishnan. And he said, what are you guys going to do? Sergey said, I told him I had no job. And Larry Page was going to go work for IBM and sit in a little cubicle and write code for the rest of his life. And the professor closed the door and said, just a minute. And he got a venture capital firm on the phone, Kleiner Perkins, and said, I have two crazies here. They don't have a business plan. They don't have a spreadsheet with estimated revenues and expenses. They don't have a corporate objectives. They have nothing, but they're sitting on top of the most elegant internet search algorithm known to humanity. Send me a check for $500,000 by messenger now. Certified check. This guy says, for you, if you're telling me this, Professor Ramakrishnan, it's got to be good. He sends a check over by messenger. Now this is what happened next. They told me. He then called Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon. And he said, you know what? I've got two crazies in here. They don't know anything. They've got an internet search algorithm. And Kleiner Perkins just gave me a check for $500,000. How much are you in for? He said, in that case, put me down for $1 million. And ladies and gentlemen, the million's worth $3 billion today. Jeff Bezos is worth $9 billion. $6 billion is Amazon. $3 billion is $1 million investment. And this is what Israel wants, which they are closing in on. Maybe they haven't. This is what is it? It's the relationship between the student and the professor. It's the relationship between the professor, number two, the professor and the venture capital. And number three, the relationship between the professor and the angel investor who did not take the company away from them. That's why they're worth both $45 billion. Because they didn't take the company away from them. The venture capitalist, if he had gotten that $1 million, not from Jeff. Jeff Bezos says, put me down. And you tell me. He said, they told me that they got Professor Chris. He said, this is Professor Ramakrishnan. Jeff Bezos of Amazon said, thank you for helping me start my company. So the trust. And that's what Israel wants. That's what China would love. It's that three-way triangle. And that's what this is. Look at this. Look at all these fun slides. Look at this. Isn't this fun? No, we're not going to go. We're not going to. How's our time, Michal? How's our time? We've done half an hour? Yeah. We've done about half an hour? We got about another half hour or so? Yeah. Michal knows that I can speak for 33 hours without stopping. I'm in the Guinness Book of World Records. Listen, demographics. As an Israeli businesswoman or businessman, Africa and these countries are going to have population growth like you can't believe. Africa is 1 billion people. Over the next 40 years, they're going to add another 1.2 billion people, which is the same size as India. Africa is going to add an India to the world. And these 10 countries, Indonesia, Vietnam, Philippines, Laos, Cambodia, Thailand, Malaysia, plus Bangladesh, Myanmar, India, Pakistan, and the Islamic Republic of Iran. Those 10 countries over the next 40 years are going to add 400, 500, 200. They're going to add another China to the world. And software, intellectual property, cybersecurity, biotech. It's be a great place to be in Israel, getting ready in the middle of all this. I just want to show you a couple of things here. It's hard to see. Jacoby, Mariana, can you see? You can't see these numbers, can you? It's hard.
Maybe you send us the presentation.
You're the teacher, I'm the student. I got to send it. Paper for you. Send it. I love that.
I can do it.
I think we've covered this pretty well. So we're going to keep going and go back here. I want to talk to you about interest rates, gold, and the dollar. And then we will start to move towards wrapping up. There's the U.S. interest rates, and you can see on this chart, they've gone up for 28 years, and they've gone down for 32 years, with some reversals. But our view is that interest rates are near a long-term low. The United States, we think, interest rates will begin to move up unless the United States is in Japan in the terms of 20 years of disinflation and deflation, in which case interest rates will go down and do like that, as they have done in Japan. Right now, 10-year U.S. Treasury is 2.6%. Japan, 0.59%. For 10 years, you're going to give the government of Japan, which is the most indebted country in the world, interest, money, for a 0.59% per year. Gold. This is when the dollar was delinked from gold. This is the Soviet Union invasion of Afghanistan. This is the hostage crisis in Iran. Gold went in 78 and 79, it was going up $100 every 6 months from a very low base. It reaches a peak of about 800 one day. This is a monthly, weekly average. Then look, it goes down for 23 years. And now it went up for 12 years, but look at this big sharp correction. Gold has been driven by China's demand, India demand, but the real drivers are interest rates have been going down for 32 years and the dollar has been going down for 12 years. Both of those we think have stopped. So gold's protectors are no longer around. That's why gold has been. Now, gold has been going up a little this year because of concerns over the Ukraine situation, and it got oversold. It fell. But we think gold is a good long-term investment, but maybe for long periods in the short term, it can be very difficult. You see here gold. 50% of all the gold ever been mined in history is in the form of jewelry, which means it's where it should be on women, except in Los Angeles where it's made by men. Okay, there's the U.S. stock market from 1982 until now. So it starts at 100. Here, look. It's going along the profits, and then it does that. What is that? The internet. That's Netscape IPO. Netscape went public on August 6, 1995, the exact same day as Jerry Garcia of the Grateful Dead died at a media event. Wall Street Journal, Rolling Stone were there. And he was a friend of the founder of Netscape, Mark Andreessen. And they resuscitated him. You understand this? They brought him back to life by breathing. And they woke up Jerry Garcia, this guitarist. And his last words were, Netscape closed at what? And then died. You can look it up. It happened. This here is the World Trade Center attack. This here is the Enron. Enron did more damage than the World Trade Center to the market. Then the market goes up. Notice the slope of that line. And then we have Lehman Brothers and AIG and Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac and Bear Stearns. And the, look how sharply it falls, 53%, a trauma. Then this, see this little blip here? That is the British Petroleum oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. And this, see that sharp drop? That is the United States debt was downgraded to AAA from AAA. But notice there's been no major correction since then. This is August of 2011, and here we are in March of 2014. And it's been going parabolic. So to us, it seems a little bit overbought. It seems overbought. We'll see what happens with this geopolitical situation. It seems a little bit overbought. It's been driven by money printing and by psychology, not by improved earnings. Earnings went up 6%. The market went up. The market went up 32%. Earnings went up 6% last year.
Unless we are in Japan. Because.
Keep going.
Because, the multiple of riskless asset, if the interest rate would go, today is 40. So the multiple of risky assets is about 18, 19, around 50%. Let's say the interest would go 350, which I don't believe it would go there. I think we are in Japan. But let's say it will go to 350. What would happen on the Dow Jones and S&P?
Jacoby is bringing up some great points. Excellent points, Jacoby. Because where I'm here on this, in some ways, this is what you want to invest. From 1948 to 1965, you basically invest with cruise control. You know what I mean? You put it on cruise control. And you buy stocks and you hold them. The 70s, no. Inflation, interest rates going up, a lot of volatility, okay? You want to drive with both hands on the steering wheel, get in, get out, okay? Trade. Then we have Reagan, Thatcher, Deng Xiaoping, Manmohan Singh in India, Bibi, Paul Martin, Fernando Henrique Cardoso, Pedro Aspe. You have these reformers. Interest rates going down, and you get a nice 18-year run. Now, Jacoby, we're going to have another one of those. I don't think it's time yet for that to start. That's my personal opinion. We could be on that. We could have had the first 3 years of 15 more years. I doubt it. So, but on the other hand, you're saying, David,
major reform that you see now, like the one in the 80s?
Structural reform is one of the components that you want to see. You want to see the people get so disgusted, they say, no more like this. And that usually is not ready yet. They're upset about, Mariana, they're upset about the health care. It's costing jobs, it's complicated, people have lost coverage, their premiums have gone up, they feel they have been not told the complete truth. So there's growing, it's not the level.
You think that the 80% that didn't get the money in the last 30, 40 years will make
They it are up. Upset. They are quite upset, and they should be. I'm amazed how passive so far But people are upset, and they have not thrown out the existing politicians and say, give us somebody. Look, Italy. Italy's been a mess. Italy has had, what is the number, 39 governments in 30 years or something crazy like this? And they got this guy, they went to this guy. I don't know if he's going to be the prophet. Okay, he's not, is he going to be Moses? I don't know. But his name is Matteo Renzi. He's 39 years old. He's the mayor of Firenze, of Florence. He says, we've got to cut taxes in Italy. We got to make it easier to hire and fire. We can't have, when you bring on an employee, you can never sell, you can never get rid of them if they're no good. So, are the Italians fed up? I don't know. The Italians for 2,000 years have been getting around regulations. So, I'm going a little bit afar from your thought about what is it going to take? Isn't that the essence?
Yeah.
What is it going to take where the people say?
Because last winter there was these riots outside of the stock exchange in New York, but still in the winter stayed in the tents and things, but it didn't
That's
catch
the
up.
Occupy Wall Street.
Yeah, but it didn't catch up, so.
It didn't catch on, it didn't catch on. The Occupy Wall Street. Now, I'm on television every Friday at the stock exchange. And while they were camping, one stop before the stock exchange is the Occupy Wall Street camp. And I would wear a three-piece suit, you understand, with a vest. And I would go there to provoke them. And they would go crazy. They said, who are you? And I would say, I go to Burning Man. You understand this? They say, please, welcome. And we would talk, and they expressing the beginnings. Look, I'm amazed that Venezuela is taking what they have. The inflation rate's 57% there. The unemployment rate is 40% official. Unofficial is probably higher. People have no education. They have more oil than anybody in the world, including Saudi Arabia. But nobody knows where the money is. That place is a South American Nigeria, okay? It's a mess, and Nigeria's a mess. The guy who is there, who's the woman in charge of the central bank here? Now, what's her name? The lady that succeeded Stanley Fisher. Madam Flug. Hey, that does not mean lose control. Madam Flug of Nigeria said, the money's disappearing from the oil. They fired him. Did you see this? This week. Just for daring to say it. What happened in the 70s to make people elect Reagan? It took a lot of bad stuff. It took Watergate. It took Vietnam. It took Bobby Kennedy being killed in 68. It took Martin Luther King being killed in 68. It took John F. Kennedy killed in 63. It took December of 1980, John Lennon shot. Everything was crazy. It took the hostages 444 days in the desert in Iran. It took, and people said, we cannot have this Jimmy Carter who's very mild and weak. So I don't know what will be the catalyst.
But we are not there yet.
I don't think so. And I think things may, yes sir, your first name?
Yusuf.
Is that like Yosef?
Yeah, then
Joseph. It means he shall add in Hebrew. Go ahead.
You were talking about structural reform, and you were also touching about unemployment, and there's this feeling or this expectation of the new unemployment, the new so-called industrial revolution, which will put people out of job without shooters creating destruction. How do you see that play out in the economy?
Everybody got that? You know, the new machines can do so much of what is done in the past. You get voicemail, you get automatic dialing, and automatic operators, everything. And even in the industrial processes, we need to retrain and retool. And let me tell you, that comes down to parents, and it comes down to schools. And the most important thing is we're sitting in a school. And when Michal said to me, would you come and speak to the school? I said, I would be so honored. Because look, these are 20 industries where it's not going to be replaced if they can find the jobs. There's 4 million jobs right now in mobile internet, quantum computing, nanotechnology, biotech, DNA sequencing, gene therapy, epigenetics, proteomics, stem cell, vaccines, shale energy, seafloor mining, alternative energy, advanced robotics, computer simulation, 3D printing, telepresence robots, biofabrication, robotic surgery, and neuromorphic processors. Has anybody ever heard of neuromorphic processors? Neuromorphic processors is Deep Blue, which beat Boris Spassky at chess.
It also won Jeopardy.
Won Jeopardy.
It won, yes.
So, and now they have it in doctor's offices. So you come in with red spots on your arm. Nobody's ever seen this before. They ask this computer. The computer's seen that over there in India someplace. Okay? This goes to Yusuf, his point, and your name?
Ben.
Ben? This goes to your points. In my humble opinion, the United States is at a crossroads right now. What's going to make it go during one or the other? Right now, there's 315 million people in the U.S. 35 million of them are in the World War II generation, known as the greatest generation. There's 80 million in my generation. There's 41 million in Generation X. And Generation Y, people don't know this, is bigger than the baby boom. There's another baby boom unfolding. These kids are young, okay? They were born, this is 1964, 46 to 64. This is 64 to 82. This is everything since 82. And then you have some new ones, 82 to 2000. And this is post 2000. So the U.S., and this is your question, Ben, Yusuf, what percent probability do each of us put on the U.S. taking the improvement now road or things get worse first? Because I do believe in the 2020s and 2030s, the U.S. and Israel will have a golden flowering age that will make the world's jaw drop by what is accomplished. But to get there, we could go through more turbulence, no structural reform, society gets crazy, and these things blow up, debt, deficit, derivatives. Or energy, the middle class. It's taken years to go from where the middle class was to low now. And it will take years to get back. You cannot flick the lights and make it happen. But you know the Airbus. You know the Airbus. Airbus A320. Airbus is owned by France and Germany. You know where they build it? Mobile, Alabama. Because, yes, they pay them $20 an hour, and they pay in China $2.60 an hour, but the productivity, okay, and the intelligence, the work ethic of that workforce. So I think it's and those are those industries we just looked at before.
But do you see any educational change that can create new workforce that can support these industries? I think that not.
Ben, we have charter schools. Now, the new mayor of New York does not like charter schools because he likes the union. They elected him, the teachers union, and he's closing the charter schools. Charter schools are like Startup Nation. Okay, they're entrepreneurial type schools. We need a space program mentality. Like Kennedy said, we're going to go to the moon. And everybody, right now, people my age and above are grandparents. I just showed me called pictures of my grandchildren. Many of them are not working, and they should be, every grandparent who wants to in the United States should be in a classroom to be there to give rabbi advice to these people. The kids, They're crying for help. The mother and father are so stressed economically, they can't be home watching the kids all the time. And school is becoming home. So if you had three or four or five grandparents, people my age who finished their careers, they have money, let them go into classroom. Two per classroom, three. They would love it. The kids would love it. This is not the answer to everything, Ben. This is one thing. This is my idea. But it's a solution, not the solution.
But there's still supposed to be educational reform, which is kind of a reform.
This charter schools, there's other kinds of educational reform brewing in different states.
Not every state is the same. Texas is different from New York.
Can we go back to the markets? From the education to the markets?
Please.
Because you started
Jacoby,
to answer me.
You have a one-track mind.
Of course.
The markets.
I'm here. I'm in the junction.
Thank you. Please. Go ahead. Because we're going to go to the markets now. But go ahead.
Yes.
Please.
What I said before. If the interest is going up,
the market can do well as long as it doesn't go to 5 or 6. You know, suddenly. Very key is how gradually the interest rises. If they go from now, which is 260,
yes,
to 350, in 1 week, the markets will go crazy on the downside.
Of course.
If they go up gradually and you see at the end of the year, oh my God, they're 360. I didn't know. The market can do better. Because higher interest rates are a sign of economic health. Not super high, but this is abnormal. But this is like a person with a walker. You understand?
But to your mind, can it be, you know, the supplementation or the grade of the interest rate going up, can it be slowly? No. Every time it happens quickly. Like from 160 to 3%. Half a year.
Listen,
from May, it raised until now.
You're making a good point, Jacoby, because the market is the Fed. The Fed's not the Fed.
Of course, that's right.
The market is the Fed, and the market will determine how fast, no matter what the Fed says.
Of course.
And it's same in Europe, too. The market is the European Central Bank. We are fooling ourselves if we think the European Central Bank and it's like a lion tamer in the circus. You know who has that power. The lion could kill the lion tamer any second if they wanted. And that's the way with the markets. They could wipe out the Fed. Now, these are for the students in this room. These are 7 things that you need to apply in your bio MBA studies. Jacoby, it has nothing to do with the market. So close your eyes. You need curiosity. You need testing. You need perception. You need flexibility. You need balance. And everyone in this room, you have 5 lives. You don't have 1 life, you have 5 lives. You have a work life, a professional life. You have a love life. Your beloved, your spouse, your kids, your parents, your brothers, your sisters. You have an athletic life of keeping reasonably fit. You have an spiritual, creative, and religious life, and you have an altruistic life to help other people. And you must keep these in balance as you go through life and never let one dominate the others. I see people in our business, the work life dominates everything, and they don't have any balance. I see others who have failed in the work life, and all they do is run marathons. Okay, and that's going to help them. No, they need to be working on balance, vigor, and judgment. Now, does anybody recognize this picture here? Yes. Do you know where it is? It's at the Louvre in Paris, and there's 2 guys there with guns. Okay, as long as the Louvre is open, they have guns, and you can see the guns. And they have a velvet rope, and then they have bulletproof glass in addition. Look, see this painting?
It hangs right next to it. And there's nobody near it. It's by him. And the art experts think it's a superior. And if you want it, you could go and deface it with a magic marker. And that's that way with investing. Sometimes there's phenomenal companies there sitting next to the company that everybody loves. Right now, everybody loves Facebook. Right now, everybody loves Alibaba. It hasn't gone public yet. Tencent, okay? Facebook, do you know what? Facebook sold for $19 billion, right? Do you know what their revenues are?
What's up?
Facebook's market capitalization is $190 billion. What's up is revenues last year? $20 million. Now, why did he buy it? To keep Google from getting it. Okay? So, for an investor, I just want to give you a little bit of a flavor as to what we would tell an investor right now. We would say, for a moderate investor, this is not a conservative, this is not aggressive, this is moderate, of medium wealth, not super rich, not just beginning. So we would say 4% in cash, 28% in bonds, 48% in stocks, and 20% in alternative investments, which is commodities, real estate, hedge funds. So if you are a global investor, you're going to have 18% US and 30% non-US. If you're a US investor, 32% US, 16% non-US. You see, 7 to 12% in Europe, 7 to 10% in Japan, and 2% in Europe, emerging markets. Not much, but too much. This is too high. It should be much lower this year. Russia, India, Brazil, China, they have not done so well this year. And I think the Ukraine thing is going to make people reconsider their emerging market allocations. Stocks, bonds, and currencies. It's happening. For bonds, 28% bonds. But notice, 15% of it is in two-year bonds, which is like cash. Emerging market bonds, zero. Now Harvard, here's Harvard's asset allocation. Harvard is 48% stocks. I think we're 48%. But Harvard is 12 US, 12 foreign, 12 emerging, and 12 private equity, direct investing directly in partnerships and companies. Harvard has 14% in commodities. We have 6%. Harvard has 9% in real estate. We have 3%. Harvard has 13% in bonds. We have 28. That's the big difference. See, they have almost no bonds, US bonds, 4%. Now, I've written a bunch of reports on gold in Japan and Mexico and Canada. You can get them if you send me an email at David.Darst@MorganStanley.com. There is my third book. How are we doing? We're all right? My fourth book. And all of the money from these two books I've given to the families of the 13 people from Morgan Stanley who were killed in the World Trade Center. It's $5 million in 9 years from these two books to them. Then this book is a big New York Times bestseller, the little book that still saves your assets. And all the money from that book goes to women's lung cancer research, non-smoking, which is what killed my wife 4 years ago. There is my book about Benjamin Graham. Has anybody ever heard of Benjamin Graham? Ben? Ben, Ben, where are you? Have you ever heard of him?
No.
He was Warren Buffett's teacher, okay? And he wrote a very famous book that's been issued for 75 years. It's in its sixth edition called Security Analysis. He is the father of value investing. And McGraw-Hill asked me to do a book about him. And I loved him. After I finished the book, I loved him. Why? He was married three times. He had five children and 12 girlfriends. And his daughters thought it was funny. Me, I'm widowed. I have one daughter. She lives five houses away from me. And she's watching me like drones over Pakistan. I get calls on the telephone. I get emails. I get texts. Daddy, what was that strange light on in the bedroom last night? You can't get to the bedroom without crawling under a fence.
So you come to Israel.
I'm going to have my aliyah right away. Now, there's my first book of creative writing, okay, which was written in honor of my wife. I'd like to just wrap up maybe with Warren Buffett's portfolio. Everybody heard of him? Very good investor. You know him, Jacoby? Look at this, Buffett. Buffett is sitting with 28% in cash and 19% in two-year bonds. He is sitting with 47% in cash. Now look at the number two here. Even with that big cash position, in the 48 years since he took control, if you gave him $19 today, 48 years later, it's $119,000. That is a compound annual rate of growth of 19.7%. Now, what are his top positions? Wells Fargo. He has $16 billion in Wells Fargo. He has $15 billion in Coca-Cola, $13 billion in IBM, $9 billion in American Express, $4 billion in Walmart, Munich Reinsurance, $3.6 billion, Procter & Gamble, which was his Gillette position. They took over Gillette. He did not sell. He took the Procter & Gamble shares. U.S. Bank Corp, Sanofi Aventis, and Tesco, which is the British Walmart. Do you see any technology companies there? IBM is not a technology company. It's a consulting company now. Happy 66th birthday, Israel, in May. And may God bless them, Israel. Thank you all.
I'll just say one sentence for the interest of time. We'll go out, we'll have a drink, and I don't know if David has to run or not, but what I like about education, and I remember that when I was a student and through my PhD and my MBA, is that the greatest thing about it is that you don't necessarily have to understand everything in the lecture. And I think there are probably very few, if any, people who can sit through David's lecture and just get every single thing. But some of the things you get and appreciate immediately, many of the things you'll learn to appreciate as you continue to learn. And you'll meet them, you'll get them later. And it's something that we aspire to do. We aspire to shoot very high, and not everything you get right off the bat, but as you move through life and as you mature and get more educated, you get better at it and you appreciate it more. So, David, thanks again. You lived up to at least my expectation. It was great. Thank you, everyone, for coming. We'll be having a toast outside, and look forward to keeping in touch with everyone. Thanks.